AKA, I call him T. Graham Brown. That's what I call him. Amen. Every time I call him, that's what I call him, T. Graham Brown. Amen. He'll answer.
Yes.
But so, hear ye, Pastor Terrance Samuels. Amen. As he give you what the Lord, amen, has given him.
Amen.
And we say amen.
Amen.
Let's just come.
It's all right.
Okay, so I'm going to do some preliminaries. You can have your seats. I'm going to do some preliminaries first. We thank God so much for being here. It's a privilege to be a vessel of Jesus. Is that all right?
Amen.
You understand that it's a privilege for God to use you? It's not, you're not doing God a service. God doing you a service.
Amen.
A lot of people think that, you know, we show up to church, well, we did God a service. I did something for God. I showed up to church.
Mm.
I did something for God. I sang my song.
Wow.
It's a privilege for you to be able to do something for God.
Amen.
And the Almighty God will give us an opportunity to participate with Him.
Yes.
Let me get my preliminaries out of the way, and I want to shoot on across the road. I have some friends here I invited, and I think I see some distinguished clergy. So if you're a clergyman, please stand and recognize you. If you're a pastor, bishop, apostle, prophet, reverend, whatever it is, come on, stand. I want to recognize you. I want to recognize. We got Mr. Walker right here, Starks, and your wife. Praise the Lord. Come on, Reverend. O.C. Hall. O.C. was a Tuesday. And Leroy O.C. Hall.
Pastor Johnson.
Pastor Johnson, great. Who else stood? Woman of God.
Minister Taylor.
Minister Taylor, wonderful. My friend is here, his wife, the Apostle Bishop Greg Thomas, and Sister Kenna, he's not going to like me for calling him out. Praise the Lord. And we have Pastor Benny Carroll, of course, and Bishop Green. Come on. All right, you have to appreciate and honor those that God has allowed to lead the body of Christ. A lot of us, I said this last night, don't move up because we don't respect or honor people. You can only go as high as your leader goes. I mean, all of us have to have a leader. Is that right? Anybody here don't have a leader? We're going to pray for you, the Lord, to send you to a leader. And let me tell you this. Don't look at your leaders. Your leaders are human. I always give this, I'm going to give this example, and I'm going to move to my next item of business. The leader, the pastor, the whomever it is, your leader, the minister, is not better than you.
Come on. Come on here.
We don't get our callings because of how good we are or because of good merit.
Amen.
I'm not better than you. Ain't nothing about me that's better than anybody else in here. The same toilet you use is the same one I use. I pay the same bills you pay, and I have the same problems you have. But a lot of time we will destroy leaders because of their humanity. Only because their stuff is on display when yours is in private.
Come on.
I get upset like you get upset. I get angry like you get upset, like you get angry. You have to respect and honor your leaders, not because there's anything special about them, because there's nothing special about us. The only thing that makes them different is He chose me and He called me for it.
Come on, yeah.
Y'all hear me?
Yeah.
That's good.
So when you get an opportunity to honor your leader, you honor your leader because many leaders, if they could do something else, but He called me. I need everybody to say He called me. Listen, I would be a lot of other stuff, but He called me. He chose me. God put His hand on me. He picked me out of the crowd, and He said, listen, I got something I want you to do. And you listen, you was messed up when He chose you, when He called you. A lot of us were in a pit when God called us. A lot of us were in some stuff when God was calling us. And I know that some young people here tonight, God is calling you. You ain't got to be perfect when you come to Him. He'll clean you up on your way. He'll clean you up as He uses you. So I need for all of us in the church to let the stand
up.
The scripture is full. I'm not even in my word yet. I gotta stop. I'm making some stuff. The scripture is full of people who wasn't about nothing when God called them. Moses was a murderer. He murdered a man and ran, and then while he's in his recovery, in his quiet place, God, he comes upon a burning bush, and God says, I choose you. Moses said, I can't even talk. How you gonna choose me? God said, listen, it's not about nothing about you. It's nothing about you that makes me choose you. You don't have to be a good talker. You don't have to be smart. You don't have to be, you don't have to come from the best family. I'll choose to use whomever I want to choose. I said, God got his hand on me. Yeah, he got his hand on everybody in here. Everybody in here, God is trying to do something with you. Come on, somebody say, God trying to do something with me.
God trying to do something with me.
Listen, he is trying to do something special with me. And what he's doing with me, I haven't seen it before. It hasn't been done before. Somebody say, what God's doing with me is unique. There's nobody else.
Nobody else.
Come on, sir.
Many times we can't grow up and become who God wants us to, we can't do the things because we study comparing ourselves to other people. And what God is doing in your life is what he's doing in your life, and it has nothing to do with my life. When God chose me, he didn't call Marcus. He didn't call John. When God was looking for somebody to use for my purpose, he called Terrence. Everybody shout your name. Everybody shout the right name. Elias, Angel, I heard names. When God wanted you, he called and created you. And he didn't say, oh, I only use you if you're perfect. I only use you if you don't make no mistakes. Now, I got to deal with this tonight before I get on out of town, y'all. I'm going to deal with this. Jesus saves us from the penalty of sin, but not from the temptation of sin. As long as you are in this flesh, you will have a tendency to sin. Now, this is hard. I've been hard. If you're a hard religious person in here, I'm going to really destroy your religion. Because you will never be free from the temptation or the access to sin. Because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Being saved don't make you sin less, but it should make you sin less. Everybody here say, I ain't perfect. Let me dig a little deeper. Let me dig a little deeper before I gotta go to my little point here. Let me dig a little deeper. Sin, at any given moment you can sin. You wanna know why? Somebody say why.
Why?
Because sin is when you go and do something you shouldn't do. When you know God told you not to do that, and you go do it, you sin. But sin is also when you do not do what he told you to go do. God said, go do that. You said, no. You sin. Now, last night I was digging a little bit about sin, and the scripture says that with the heart you believe. So where does faith start?
In the heart.
So if anything is not of faith is sin, then, and so the opposite of faith is not fear, the opposite of faith is what? Sin. Romans 14:23. Anything that is not of faith is sin. Faith says, I do things God's way. Sin says, I do things my way. Now watch this, I'm gonna bless your life. So if faith starts in the heart, where does sin start? In the heart. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. So when in your heart you have made the desire, the decision, or live out the desire to do, to live life in your own understanding, you are in sin. Is that clear?
That's
Yeah.
Now, on a daily basis, we all at some point decide we're going to do something our way. Are you learning right now?
Good.
So you will never be free from the effects of sin or the temptation of sin. But you are delivered and free from the penalty of sin. Jesus has delivered you from the penalty of sin. That means that when you close your eyes and you've been saved for real, you're going to see Jesus when you go.
Hallelujah.
In spite of all the times you sin. It's hard. It's hard. Which is why the church has got to be the place where a sinner can come. You invited. Come on to church. We have got, the church has got to stop shutting people out.
Come on here.
Come on in here. Come on in here. Come on in here. Come on, no. Because the only way that you're going to get better from your sin sickness is the power of God, the love of the Lord, the word of God, and the fellowship with the believers. You got to get around people that's walking with God for real. If you got some fake Christians around you, you need to get rid of them. No more fakes. Somebody say no more fakes. Because listen, sin is a sickness.
Yeah.
And so I can't afford to be hang my time around sick people, or else I'm gonna stay sick. Yeah. But Jesus says the sick, the healthy people have no need of a physician. Yeah. Jesus says, I'm your healer, I'm your physician. And if you just come to me, all ye that are heavy laden and that's weary and tired, I will give you rest. Somebody shout, come to Jesus. Church. The church has to be a place for Jesus. That means that our worship has to be right. Our word has to be right. That means when you come in here, you gotta feel like that Jesus was in the building with you. You gotta feel like that you're actually getting healed by the word of God. You're being healed by the worship. That's why we gotta be ready. We gotta be understanding of what we sing about. We can't sing songs that's all about, oh, won't he work it out for me? It's about me. Our songs have to be about him. Jesus is life.
Yes,
he gives us life. He gives us life.
Yes, he does.
He gives us, I'm not talking about when you're dead. I'm talking about
right now.
Jesus will give you life right now.
Yes.
When you really trust him, when you really believe in him, when you believe that he is alive today, Jesus Christ will give you life.
Yes, he will.
Thank
you. A lot of times, you know, and I know we got some educated preachers in here. You know, we get all educated. And I'm, you know, I'm going to go to school. You know, yeah, I want to be great. I'm going to get all I got to get out of that. But at the end of the day, the gospel can be spoken in four words.
Mm-hmm. Teach us.
The gospel.
Mm-hmm.
Well, anybody, I think somebody young. What's the gospel?
The word of God.
Word of God, yes. What else? What's another word for it? The gospel?
The
good news. Thank you. The good news. Somebody say good news.
Good news.
The gospel is actually can be expressed in four words. Christ died for sinners. That's the gospel. In four words. Christ died for sinners. The gospel has nothing to do with money. It's not about money. It's not about friends. It's not about family. The gospel is, I'm a sinner, and Jesus died for me to be saved.
Thank you, Jesus.
So that I could live. In John 3:15, 3:16, they use two different words. He says, anybody who believes, who has the Son, has eternal life. Then verse 16 says, y'all know it, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes may have everlasting life. And eternal life is life in time, but everlasting life is life that won't stop. Let me tell you the specific difference about it. When you get saved, you have life in you that will never be taken away from you when you believe in Jesus.
Mm. Amen.
Life, joy, peace. These are the fruit of the Holy Spirit: love, joy, peace. So when we make Christ our focus, then it doesn't matter what's going on around us. I can be stable. I can live in wholeness. Somebody say wholeness.
Wholeness.
Because of the reality of Jesus. Because who Jesus is in my heart, I'll never lack nothing. He'll never leave me and never forsake me. I have everything I need in Jesus. Somebody say, I got everything I need in Jesus.
I got everything I need in Jesus.
And I'm going to say this prophetically. Many of us right now, when I'm talking to them, the sound of my voice, need to cut people go because we depend so much on people that we worship man. And we're looking for every opportunity to be affirmed by people. We're always looking for a chance, man of God. We're always looking for somebody to pick us up. And always looking for somebody to look, see me, love me, please help me, help me. Listen, when you cut all the noise out and focus on the Lord, then you'll know how to navigate through. You know who to keep in your life and who to cut away. And I'm going to get in my message, my real message, I'm going to talk about cutting some stuff away. But we have to really focus on Him and make sure that whatever we are doing, we're trying to do it to please Him. Many of us suffer from people-pleasing syndrome. We sick from suffering trying to be accepted by people.
Come on.
Please,
you show
my
right.
Friend. Please, my friend. Oh, they don't want me, my friend.
Mama.
You don't want to help me out. You won't let me sing. You won't let me preach.
Come on.
In the church.
Come on.
We suffer from trying to be accepted by people. Let me express something to you. You have already been accepted by Jesus. You are good enough for God. Somebody say, I'm good enough.
I'm good enough.
For God.
For God.
Doesn't matter who has rejected you, neglected you, you are good enough for God. If God wanted something else, He wouldn't have made you. But He made me. Somebody say He made me.
He made me.
A few things I need to really, really deal with. How many of you were here last night? Raise your hand if you were here last night. All right. How many of you were blessed from last night? You feel like, okay. All right, I'm going to give room for three people to say something that they got from last night. Come on, just raise your hand. Come on, somebody say something. Not you, Justin. Somebody say something you got. Anybody. Say something that you received from last night.
I got peace.
Come on, you got peace?
Yes,
ain't he all right? He'll give you peace. Did you sleep well last night?
Yes, I did.
Yeah, because the Lord worked it out.
Faith.
Huh? Faith. You got faith? You believe in God for something? Little faith. One more person, I'm going to move on. One more person that was here last night, you got something. Okay, Josh, you can say it.
Pour out a blessing.
Pour out a blessing? Yeah, pour out a blessing. I love it. We have to make sure, and I know I'm a little unconventional tonight, but sometimes we can get so used to doing things the way we do them, and people don't know how, they just, if I was still behind that pulpit, y'all would've been like, y'all would've left, desensitized, I'm gone. Oh, I'm supposed to clap when you get loud.
Keep it real.
Yeah. Let me talk to my leaders in here. We have to be willing to change it up.
That's right.
Amen.
Because your people are over you.
That's right. That's good. Quiet.
That's it.
They sick. They tired. They listen. After, you know, it's the same old thing. Come in here. We're going to pray. We're going to sing. We're going to preach. There we go. Yeah. And your lives are not a reflection of what God is doing. So that means as leaders, we have to be willing to change it up. That's why I say, I want to preach from down here tonight. I want to be in your face.
Just go ahead.
Spit on you. If a spit drop come out, I want to be able to land on your forehead. I need you close enough. I need you to laugh in church. You know, y'all, listen, if the Lord gives you joy, why are you so mean and your face just bitter and ugly?
Come on, here.
Gives you joy.
Yeah.
Why makes you smile sometimes? Why is it if the Lord gives you joy, why are you coming in church with your face tore up?
Wow. All right.
Say, fix your face.
Fix your face. Oh, Lord. Fix it.
He's been good to you.
Yes, he has.
You might not have the money you want. You might not have the job you want. You might not have the friends you want, the marriage you want. You might not have what you want, but you're going to thank God that you're still alive.